Hey, welcome back to the Caffeinated Thoughts podcast. This is Shane Vanderhart. We're going to have a great episode this week. Former Congresswoman Marilyn Musgrave, who's from Colorado, served Colorado. She's currently the Vice President of Governmental Affairs with Susan B. Anthony List, joins us to discuss the pain-capable Unborn Child Protection Act that the U.S. House will be voting on next Tuesday. But first, a word from our sponsors.
At American Principles Project, we believe that human dignity should be at the heart of public policy. We work in all 50 states and in Washington, D.C. to promote life, religious freedom, local control over education, authentic economic progress for working Americans, and a return to constitutional principles such as federalism. Want to help American Principles Project? Visit our website today, AmericanPrinciplesProject.org. That's AmericanPrinciples, P-L-E-S, Project.org. Sign up for email updates. Help us out. We want to work with you. That's AmericanPrinciplesProject.org.
Hi, this is Brian Myers. When I needed a better life insurance plan, I found it with Travis Risvold of Modern Woodmen of America. When I first met Travis, he wasn't like some other life insurance agents that can be pushy and try to get you to buy something. Travis just made himself available to me. That was it. He told me to let him know if and when I needed anything, and he stayed in touch. When the day came and I did need to make some changes with my life insurance, Travis met with me and walked me through several options so I could make an informed decision. Ultimately, it was the best decision for my situation. So if you need a better or the best life insurance plan for you, call my friend Travis Risvold with Modern Woodmen. His number is 515-883-0029. Travis Risvold with Modern Woodmen. He can help you find the life insurance you need. Call him at 515-883-0029.
And we're back. Hey, this is Shane Vanderhart again, and here's a conversation I had with Congresswoman Musgrave today. So, Congresswoman Musgrave, thank you for joining us. I just would like to ask you, first of all, what does the Pain-Capable Unborn Child Protection Act do?
Well, it saves babies after the fifth month of pregnancy. Now, I am pro-life. Susan B. Anthony List is pro-life. We want to save all babies. But this is a strategy that we have. This is a piece of legislation carried by Trent Franks from Arizona. And the beautiful thing about this, the Unborn Child Pain Capable Act, is making people think about the baby at the point in the development where the baby can feel pain. Mm-hmm. So it's banning abortion after this point in the pregnancy. It has passed the House previously. It's up for a vote again on Tuesday. There was a press conference held by the majority leader, Kevin McCarthy from California. That was an incredible gesture of support for the bill. And he announced that the vote would be on Tuesday. There will be special orders, a time where the members of the House of Representatives on Monday evening are talking about their support of the bill. And I look forward to that. You know, science is catching up with the pro-life movement. And it's a beautiful thing when people can see the unborn child in the womb through the ultrasound. It's an incredible thing when doctors go around this country in the 20 states that have passed this legislation at the state level to explain scientifically how the child at this point can feel pain. It's making people really think about abortion, what it does. And I'm very pleased that we've had a good week with the press conference. We've had the Pickering family here from Newton, Iowa, and with their beautiful little son, Micah, who's now in kindergarten. He was born at 20 weeks. So it's good for these members of Congress to see this little boy and to think about the development of the child at that particular point in the pregnancy and how we should end late-term abortion.
Well, definitely, yeah. Micah definitely stands out as an example of why late-term abortion is unnecessary with not only the prenatal care but the neonatal care and how these kids are able to. I myself was a premature baby. I don't remember exactly how young I was, but that was back in 1972. And I know they've made a lot of advancements since then. I want to also ask you about the science. You mentioned the science behind the Pain Capable Act. Could you kind of explain how they've figured that out? What studies have been done? As best you can, anyway.
Well, our research arm, Charlotte Lozier Institute, is a wonderful counter to the Guttmacher Institute. I'm a former state legislator as well as a member of Congress, and I know the other side, the pro-abortion crowd, always cited Guttmacher. Well, it's right. A good day when you're in states like Ohio, when Charlotte Lozier Institute can have doctors come and testify on the development of the cortex and other things in the baby that indeed do allow them to feel pain. I'm not a doctor, but their research is there for everyone to see at the Charlotte Lozier website, and it's very authoritative. It's a good day when doctors can testify to the ability of the child to feel pain. And again, we're not talking about a procedure. We're not talking about other things. We're talking about the unborn child. And I think that's a good thing for Americans to do, to think about that unborn child, to think about the taking of innocent life. And even people that consider themselves pro-choice, that wonderful euphemistic term,
right?
Many of them still believe that banning abortion after this point in the pregnancy is appropriate. So when you drill down, they're more pro-life than they think. So they say we shouldn't allow abortion after this point. It's above 60%. And interestingly enough, women feel very strongly about this in higher numbers, and millennials, because many of those millennials, I would guess, have seen their siblings in the ultrasound. They
right.
get it. Very different from the day when I first was in the pro-life movement as a very young woman, when they talked about, the other side talked about a blob of tissue. Boy, we know that's not true anymore.
Very true.
And that unborn baby is there for all the world to see. Surgeries are performed on these babies in the womb. They receive anesthesia because there is a better medical outcome when they don't feel the pain of the surgery. I mean, the science is there. It is obvious that the child feels pain at this point in the pregnancy. And that's why the majority of Americans think that abortion should be ended at this point. And as for you and me and others, we want all abortion ended. But this is the incremental step that we're taking.
You mentioned something about with neonatal surgery and giving anesthesia to preborn babies. I just kind of playing devil's advocate here, and not that I really want to do that, but couldn't an argument be made for, because I think I've actually seen a bill that did this, to actually pass a bill based on this science saying, hey, if we give the child anesthesia, then you know, let's go ahead and do the abortion.
Well, it's really quite amazing how creative the other side is. And I guess that's the beauty of naming this bill the Unborn Child Pain Capable Act. Because when they introduce legislation like that and they promote those ideas, it's admitting that this baby can feel pain at this point in the development. And so, again, I would just say we need to go along with pro-life people, people that don't even call themselves pro-life, but know that we should end abortion after this point in the pregnancy. The barbaric nature of abortion is so exposed when people put forth these ideas.
How is this law, if it's passed, or bill, if it's passed into law, how will it be enforced?
Well, the good thing about this bill is that it's passed the House previously. It will pass the House again on Tuesday, and then it will go to the United States Senate, where it will have a much tougher route. And before we even think of abortion, I think we need to realize that we still have a ways to go to get 60 votes in the United States Senate. But one of the most encouraging things is that this president made four commitments to pro-life people around this country. And one of the commitments was to sign Unborn Child Pain Capable Act into law. And so we have that going for us, but we're going to have to be very tenacious in regard to getting 60 votes in the United States Senate. There will be situations where we have to think about enforcement. We have to think about what will happen if the baby is born alive, and the bill allows for another doctor to be able to be there to be able to help the baby. So these are things that will work out as we go, but my goal right now is working towards 60 votes in the United States Senate, so indeed we can get this to the President of the United States, who has committed to sign it into law.
So, for lack of a better word, who are some of the problem children in the Senate, other than Democrats?
Well, there are a couple of Republicans that are often not there for us. Susan Collins from Maine, Lisa Murkowski from Alaska, Joe Manchin from West Virginia has called himself pro-life. He's kind of gone back and forth on defunding Planned Parenthood, so that's interesting. He's voted both ways. And then Joe Donnelly and Bob Casey, whose father has an incredible pro-life story where he was not allowed to speak at the Democratic National Convention because he was a pro-life Democrat.
Right.
So there are some people. Heidi Heitkamp from a very pro-life state, North Dakota, angst over a bill like this. She's out of step with her state if she votes against it.
Right.
So Everett Dirksen once said, "When I feel the heat, I see the light." So we're hoping that when this comes for a vote in the United States Senate, that some of those people will feel some heat, especially from their pro-life state constituents.
Definitely. So has there been any legal challenges to these bills at the state level?
There have been states. It's passed in 20 states, and so far, so good.
Okay. All right, so moving on to one of the things that I know that we hope to see with this Republican Congress and Republican president is to see Planned Parenthood defunding, and they don't seem to be able to get there. What's your thoughts on that?
Well, first of all, we were promised by Leader McConnell, we were promised by the Speaker of the House that they would work very hard to redirect this money to providers that did not do abortion, to defund Planned Parenthood, and here we are all these months later and it's not happened. And we've seen two attempts in the United States Senate to repeal and replace Obamacare that included defunding of Planned Parenthood that have not passed. So it has been very frustrating, very devastating, and now there's another reconciliation bill. And people out there, you know, wonder, well, what is a reconciliation bill? Well, it is a budget bill, and
right.
it gets around the filibuster, and then it can be passed with 51 votes. And quite frankly, given the makeup of the United States Senate, that's the only way we're going to pass defunding of Planned Parenthood. So we're saying now, okay, you didn't get it passed on repeal and replace the 2017 reconciliation bill. Now you're taking up the 2018 reconciliation bill, defund Planned Parenthood in that one. So that is, I've been on the Hill several days this week lobbying on that. So we'll see how that goes. It's going to be a very heavy lift from us, but it's a most reasonable ask of this pro-life Congress.
Right.
And so they need to get it done. They need to care as much about life as they do tax reform. Life needs to be up there at the top of the list.
So some of the troubling senators would be against Susan Collins. Would probably drag her feet on that. Lisa Murkowski. You know if John McCain would support this measure?
I do not know. I think that it's always good for those kind of people that we can't depend on regularly to have to take a vote and show everyone where they really stand. And for senators that care a great deal about tax reform and, you know, lowering taxes for people, lowering the corporate tax rate, we need to say to them, life is just as important, and just let them show everyone where they stand on this issue.
All right, Congresswoman, thank you so much for your time. I appreciate it.
You're very welcome.
Have a great week.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Hey, thank you for taking the time to listen, and I would like to encourage you to make sure that you contact your member of Congress about this bill. Again, it's the Pain Capable Unborn Child Protection Act. Basically, in 2015, as Congresswoman Musgrave mentioned, it passed the House. It passed on a 242-184 vote. However, it got stalled in the Senate. It failed to get cloture on a 54-42 vote. It takes, if you remember, 60 votes to be able to get passed, to be able to invoke cloture. So we're going to need to really call up on this bill, especially when it gets to the Senate. Anyway, you can learn more. Go to sbalist.org. That's SBA, actually, -list.org. They got information there. If you would like to read about the science of this bill, you go to lozierinstitute.org. They've got the studies available there. That's a great outfit. Anyway, this is Shane Vanderhart. Also, would like to encourage you, you know, we have a podcast, but we blog too. Check us out, caffeinatedthoughts.com. If you're listening to us some other means other than the website, be sure to check out caffeinatedthoughts.com. We appreciate it. Hey, take care, everybody. See you next time.